Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magne Nordahl. I am an ATR instructor. I have flown this aircraft for about 25 years and I'm still learning. Today I will talk about landing in crosswind. In all aircraft, crosswind requires a special technique. And for the ATR, the technique is to fly with crab on final. And during the flare, you decrab, which means you apply rudder to align the centerline of the aircraft parallel with the runway centerline. And you try to get as close as possible to the centerline. And then you use the ailerons to produce a bank to prevent you from drifting away. You touch down on the main wheel on the wind side with a low wing, and then the other main wheel will touch down, and after that the nose wheel. Don't hold the nose up, just let it settle down immediately after landing, because with the nose wheel on the ground you have better directional control. ATR-72 has a max demonstrated crosswind component of 45 knots. The ATR-42 has 45 for takeoff and 44 for landing flaps 35. The reason the ATR-42 has a more crosswind is because of the shorter arm, which means there are less moment from the wind pushing on the tail fin. That said, those values are demonstrated in stable wind conditions by a test pilot. So therefore, if you experience a gusty wind, for example, maybe 25 gust 35, that means it will vary a lot. And that requires more attention from the pilot. Many companies also put limitations on the first officer, maybe max 50 knots. And these numbers are valid for a dry runway. For a wet runway, it's reduced for ATR-72, 28 knots. And then with contaminated runway, standing water, slush, snow, ice, it goes all the way down to 10 for the ATR-72. Okay, that's the theory. I want to highlight the force of the wind pushing on the tail fin. Because the force increases with the square of the velocity of the wind. So at phi squared is 25, and you double the wind to 10, you get 100. You increase to 15, now we get 225, and you increase to 200, you get 400. That's four times as much as for 10 knots. 25 knots, 625, and 30, it's 900. That's four times stronger than for 15. 35, 12, 25, and 40, 1600. And for 45 knots, it's 2025. So we're talking about a strong increase of the force and the moment here. As I said, the technique is to fly with a crab into the wind. So at about 35 knots, you will have roughly 20 degrees crab to stay on the center line. And as you start to flare, you also start to decrab, and you apply, in this case, wind is from the right, so you apply left rudder to rotate the nose so it's parallel with the center line, and you apply bank so you can control. Lot of bank, you move right, little bank, and you move to the left so you can control your position. And during the flare and landing, your speed change, the wind can change closer to the ground, so you have to make continuous corrections all the way. And here is something quite interesting, because the localizer antenna is in the tail fin. Center of gravity is here, and you are sitting here in the front of the aircraft. So when you're flying in a strong crosswind, remember, with an ILS localizer, The localizer will align the tail fin with the center line of the runway. While you are seated on the side of the center line, you agree about that? Yes. And when you push the rudder, the aircraft rotates around here. So now you know, swing towards the left. And if you already put your cockpit over the center line on final, push the rudder, you're suddenly way off. And you don't want to land on the lee side of the runway because the runway is not flat. It's slanted sideways to allow for water drainage. I exaggerated here, it's between 1 and 2 degrees sideways. So it's always the best to land on the center line. Never land on the lee side. If you land on the upwind side, it's okay. You will naturally get a 1 degree bank on the ground, which may make direction control a little more easy. And after touchdown, direction control with your feet only, going to ground idle, and ailerons, as your speed decreases, you have to apply more and more and more aileron into the wind. And you have to keep it down to 40 knots, okay? That's the theory. Let's go into the simulator and have a look. But now, minimum. I will not decrab. I will just continue. A little high there.
100. Fifty, 40, 30, 20,
I just started 10. Oh, that was a bad landing. And this is caused by poor technique, no decrab.
Approaching minimums.
Your damper is off, that's very important for crosswind.
Minimums.
Continue. Little high and glide slow, not much.
100. 50.
Start
40.
Decrab.
30. 20.
Align with the runway. Touchdown on the right main wheel, then left, and then the nose wheel. Okay, we are on final with 35 knots crosswind. And here is a hack. You see that magenta diamond? It shows the ground track. And on HSI, I have the course selector, CDI, for the approach, 195. So if the diamond is also 195, I will be exactly parallel with the runway.
500.
Now I'm centered on the localizer. So that means I'm on the localizer as well. Little low here. Correcting back. The odometer is off. Stabilized.
One hundred. 50.
Start
40. 30. 20.
Banking.
10.
Touchdown. This sim behaves a bit different from the aircraft, for sure. The important thing is to keep your ailerons steady into the wind, because if you sit like driving a car, then the ailerons go up and down, the spoiler goes up and down, and that never works. You have to be consistent and apply pressure in there. As a speed increase, you need more and more. Okay, that's not a simulator. Okay, that's all for this time. I hope you enjoyed the video. And a big thank you to all the supporters of this channel. They helped me produce this. So, thank you for watching. Have a wonderful day and happy landing.